everybody. I hope you guys can hear me okay tonight. It's great to be back with everybody this evening. I hope everyone had a great Feast of the Incarnation. I'm very excited to be with you guys after that. It's still in the Christmas spirit, so, you know, I got on my very cozy Christmas sweater here. I really like this one a lot. It's very loud. This one's very obnoxious, very loud, but it's fun. It's a fun sweater, so hope you guys will appreciate that. Tonight we're going to be talking about something that's, this might take a while, but hopefully it won't be too dry. And this is going to be a great video probably to send an Orthodox or to send someone who's maybe Protestant, but mostly I think Eastern Orthodox. I'm really going to be responding to one of their, I guess, negative claims is that dogma does not really progress. They're very Orthodox, committed. They're very committed to the idea that their church, their institution, does not have any progression of dogma, or the tradition has remained the same. It is the church of the apostles, as the apostles understood it and the apostles talked about things, is the church of the Eastern Orthodox. They have the same conception, the same framework, and everything else. And so tonight I'm going to be talking about what dogmatic progression is, what it means, and helping people understand it, so that way people can respond to ideas of like the papal infallibility and purgatory, things like this. And we see in the way we talk about these things is obviously not going to be in the same terms as they talked about them in the early church. And so why is that the case? That's basically the question we're going to talk about tonight. And this show, this video is going to be about pretty much, does it happen? Does dogma develop? And then the second part, which will happen either tomorrow or another time, will be on where is there valid organic development? So tonight's going to be that it does happen. I want to make the case that it does progress. Everyone has to admit it progresses. It's reasonable to say it progresses. Then the second video will be about like setting up, I would say, reasonable, sensible criteria about when you can say this is organic, natural development, in the same way that a child develops into an adult, but this, you know, it's the same person, the same individual. How does the church develop? How does the church better understand herself and her dogma? And that is going to, we're going to set up some criteria based on the writings of the church fathers, based on just what is reasonable and sensible history, etc. That'll be a different video. And then I'll apply these standards to things like the papacy and purgatory another time in the future as well. All right. So that'll be kind of tonight's objective. Is my voice coming in okay? Someone in chat, maybe you could tell me real quickly. Is my voice okay? Doesn't sound off tonight. I'm just making sure. Someone let me know if it sounds weird or anything like that. So to begin, we're going to talk about first what is absolute progression. Absolute progression is the idea that God is publicly revealing truths which he had not formally made known in the past. In other words, the deposit of faith, or those things which are contained for our belief, is growing absolutely. There's more things being given. And so if you look at like Jesus, obviously Jesus was growing there's this absolute progression in the teachings of Jesus Christ. There's this absolute progression in the teaching of the apostles. And then that is distinct from relative progression. Relative progression is formally made known truths. So they're already known, but they have not been clearly proposed by the church, or that we can understand them better. They're not well understood yet. And so we can grow in our knowledge of the truth because of more clear and explicit teaching from the church. That's what relative progression means, is that, yes, they have been revealed in an absolute sense. They're contained in the deposit of faith, but they're not well understood, and the church has not proposed them in the most clear terms or something like that. All right. So those are two definitions here. And again, kind of waiting on chat to make sure. I want to make sure the volume is okay and everything. But no one seems to be responding. Okay. And I want to make it clear, though, that dogmatic progression is not the same thing as like evolution. All right. Sometimes you might hear people say talk about like the evolution of dogma, and this is a very modernist concept. Dogmas, and it basically presupposes this idea, this rationalist idea, or this idea that the church is this collective consciousness of believers, and therefore the church can do away with certain dogmas it no longer needs, or that are no longer helpful. For example, certain dogmas that relate to like contraception or something like that. Someone who believes in dogmatic evolution would say, yeah, the church at one time taught that that contraception is wrong and bad and all of that, but today we can evolve, we are more progressive, we don't need to worry about that. That's not at all what I'm talking about here in progression. Progression is not the same as evolution. We're not saying that dogmas can disappear or that they could be ever contradicted. That is definitely not what I'm saying. Now, objective progression, this absolute sense of progression, it continued in the Old Testament with the teachings of Jesus Christ, but it ended, according to most people, with the death of the last apostle. So after the death of the last apostle, the absolute progression of dogma has ended. And this is proved by the fact that any new piece of revelation, so any new piece of revelation that God could, you know, show us or reveal, it would either have to do two things. It would have to change the, it would have to be like oriented towards changing two things, basically. It'd have to change the economy of the church. In other words, that there was something in the church that's wrong, and there needed to be some change. And that's why there would have to be some absolute growth. And God would have to come down and say, okay, this is what needs to happen. Or it would add to the existing deposit of faith. It would just add something maybe interesting or something new there. However, we know that the economy of the church is immutable and as eternal as God is. And so there is nothing that could be insufficient within the tradition or within scripture or within the economy of the church that would require some change. And there wouldn't be everything also that is necessary for salvation and everything that is needed for producing good works and living a good Christian life. It's all contained in the scriptures. It's all contained in the deposit of faith, materially in the scriptures, but into the two sources, scripture as well as the tradition, the oral tradition, it's contained therein in its full sufficiency. There's no reason why God would withhold any of that. And so, in other words, the apostles, they were the last people, since they were on Pentecost imbued with the Holy Spirit. They were imbued with the Holy Spirit, and therefore they were infused with so much knowledge that they were the last people who could basically reveal certain absolute truths, or add the absolute dogmas. And so sorry to the Mormons and to, I don't know if there's other groups, but mostly Mormons who think that like Joseph Smith had some new revelation, but that would seem to be very unlikely, if not impossible, given the fact that new revelation or some new increase in the absolute dogma would contradict the economy of the church. It would presuppose that the church is not sufficient, or that the scripture or the Bible is not sufficient. In both those cases, is not true. So now moving on to more the relative progression. And so the absolute progression, that's done. It's sealed, set in stone. No one, Christian Orthodox Christian, would tell you that the absolute set of dogmas has changed. Now, when it comes to relative dogmatic progression, that's what I'm going to be focusing on tonight, is how the church clarifies and proposes certain teachings and how that changes throughout the ages. And here's the controversy. Here's like the controversy of what I'm talking about. The Eastern Orthodox, and to some extent Protestants as well, and they claim that Catholic dogma has engaged in basically accretions or novelties, new things that they kind of just invent out of thin air or based on very flimsy evidence, like papal supremacy, purgatory. They say that our rejection of sola fide is maybe an accretion, and so things like that. They say that the Catholic Church is like invented these things in the Middle Ages, or at least they began. You see real development of these things in the Middle Ages or the 5th century by Gregory the Great, by Pope Gregory the Great. They would say that you start to see these things and that they're not contained in the deposit of faith. And the Eastern Orthodox in particular are very keen on mentioning this. They believe that their traditions are literally basically the exact same as like the early church. And if you look at like their fasts, the Eastern Orthodox still maintain like the fast of the early church. They're very, very rigorous about their fasting. You have to be basically vegan plus no oil. So all the requirements for vegan, so no eggs, no dairy, no meat at all, not even fish. They all hold to that very strictly. And whereas the Catholic Church understands that those kinds of disciplinary pastoral initiatives, they're not even dogma. They're not even tradition with a capital T. They're simply like the tradition of man, and therefore they can't change. But that's for a different time to talk about. But my point is that the Orthodox, they very much oppose dogmatic progression. And it's mainly because they have no consistent organ which could facilitate dogmatic progression. They haven't had an ecumenical council in the last like 1,000 years. And so without an ecumenical council, you really can't have a magisterial body proposing or clarifying things for the church as a whole, as a universal church. So that's kind of where I believe this idea comes from, but that is something that they very stick to, is that the way in which we talk about things like the Eucharist needs to be the same way that the early church talked about. However, my contention tonight, my claim tonight, my argument tonight is going to be that dogmatic progression has happened, even before the, you know, the Great Schism, or before the Reformation, and it's happened in, you know, a long time, like I said, before all these events. And the question isn't, is dogmatic progression valid? I don't think that should be the question, but rather, why isn't papal supremacy or purgatory, why aren't these valid forms or valid expressions of dogmatic progression? And so this shifts the onus to the Protestants and to the schismatic Orthodox, so that now it's the burden of proof is on them. So that's my goal tonight, is to prove to like just that dogmatic progression is real. And then in the next video, like I said, I'll talk about setting up a criteria for understanding dogmatic progression, but I think it's sensible, and when it's valid standard. And then maybe I'll do another video about applying this to something like the papacy. And so to bring out clearly the truth of this proposition that I'm defending, that there is relative, again, this is a relative progression of dogma, we need to show basically four things here. And so here I got a whiteboard, as I know everyone likes the whiteboards. And so here's the whiteboard here. So we need to show four things basically. The first is that some truths in the DF, or deposit of faith, are obscure. In other words, that some truths that are contained are in the deposit of faith or in the sources of revelation, whether in sacred tradition or in the Holy Scriptures, they're obscured in some fashion. And I'll do another video on the perspicuity of Scripture, because I understand that this relates very intimately with the perspicuity of Scripture in some sense, but also I would say they're not exactly the same. And then the second thing is, so once I'm able to kind of demonstrate this, then I have to go on to the second kind of challenge or question, or the statement rather, more proposition. And I have to prove that the church did not immediately at its conceptions of the church in the very beginning, at like the first council of Jerusalem or the first few councils in the first 100 years, it didn't immediately proclaim truths that were clear and in unmistakable terms. So it was not the case that the apostles taught clearly all the truths in Revelation, that there are some obscure truths they taught. And then second, that the church did not clarify on these obscure truths, so they remained obscure. And then the third point is that the church did clarify with time. So the church later on, as the passage of time, did propose those truths in a clear-cut way for our belief after some time had passed. And then this same process can occur in the future. That's the fourth part, that the same process can occur in the future. Why can't it occur in the future? That's basically the fourth contention that I need to show, is that the same process can in fact occur. This cycle of you have some obscure thing in the positive faith that has not been clarified in the early church, one of the church fathers, writings of church fathers or something like that. The church has dealt with these before, as the passage of time has approach. And then, of course, if that's true, then the church can do this in the future. Or why couldn't it do in the future? That would be kind of a question that I have to kind of answer or defend, is that the church could do this, in fact, in the future. All right. So the first part, some truths, and like I said, here, let me take a pause real quickly to say, if you're interested in supporting the stream, supporting what I do, here's a link to the Entropy. I'll put that in chat. Thank you to the Patreon supporters as well. Really appreciate your donations. I'm right now applying to graduate school. Graduate school is very expensive to apply to. Hopefully I'll get a fellowship so it doesn't cost any money, but it cost me like $75 per application, and I'm applying to like 9 schools, so you do the math. And so it gets a little expensive, so I appreciate the donations, especially from the Patreon supporters. The regular donation really does help me out, so appreciate that. There's the Entropy link as well. And then, like I always say, at the end of the stream, I'll answer whatever questions you guys have from Entropy or through the chat. So like I said, tonight I'm going to be talking about dogmatic progression. Alright, so first, the first thing that I need to prove is that some truths are contained in the sources of Revelation, the two sources, Scripture, Holy Tradition, in some obscure fashion. And while all truths require equal assent of faith, not all are equally necessary. That's the first thing that needs to be said here. That all truths that are revealed by God do require an equal assent of the faith. They require us to assent to it equally, but not all truths are equally necessary for salvation or for living a good life. God, in his exuberant generosity, has revealed to man many truths, which are not directly related to morals or to salvation. For example, like angelology or Mariology, and regardless of whether you're Protestant, Orthodox, Catholic, Lutheran, these things are not angelology, Mariology, etc. These are not as necessary as, for example, soteriology. A knowledge of which it may be useful, it may be pastoral, but it is not necessary. And like I said to people in the chat, I will answer the questions after I finish the main exposition of this show. Alright. Those truths which are necessary for Christian living, for example, baptism or baptismal regeneration, the true presence of Christ in the Eucharist, that Christ is our Savior, that it's through his work on the cross, it's through his merit and atoning sacrifice that we're saved. Those ideas should be taught by the apostles in very clear and explicit terms. They should be, it makes sense that they ought to be, and they have been. And they are contained very explicitly in the writings of the patristics, and I mean that very literally. Most every father that I've read, and every father that scholars that I've read have read, like Dr. Cooper and others, and Jimmy Akin, they've affirmed that the church fathers hold that to baptismal regeneration, that it is through baptism that we receive the grace needed for salvation. And that is why Lutherans, Catholics, Eastern Orthodox, they all hold to baptismal regeneration. It's because this is very clearly set forth at the very beginning of the church. And in every age, the church has affirmed this truth. Excuse me. Though, of course, just knowing that these truths are necessary for salvation, and with the necessity of these truths, it does not entail that we have to have a scientific or metaphysical, systematic understanding of them. You can explain, for example, that like what baptism is, that you need to be baptized, and that it needs to be triune, and there needs to be water poured over your head, without having to get into some sacramental theology, systematic sacramental theology about matter and form and intent and those kind of concepts. And so now to the non-necessary dogmas that pertain to a more exact or to a deeper exposition of the faith. And so there are certain dogmas that are non-necessary, but they basically allow us to have a deeper or more exact understanding of the faith. It would not be surprising to find that some of them should be handed down in kind of an obscure fashion, or in perhaps implicit terms, or perhaps vague terms, it is in fact, I would say, impossible for the apostles to enunciate these ideas, enunciate these very like systematic, very thorough ideas, looking at these non-necessary elements of theology in explicit terms, and it's not because like the apostles were idiots. It's not because the apostles lacked a grasp on the inspired content. No, they were infused with the truth, but it's rather because the very nature of the doctrine, the time period they lived in, the method of the apostolic preaching, these things blocked such an exposition. And so it's not that they were dumb and they just didn't have a grasp on it, and that's why they taught things in some things in obscure ways, but it's just the nature of the situation. And like I said, the apostles were infused with the truth. At Pentecost, they were infused by the Holy Ghost. And they had an intimate connection to the entire gamut of revelation. The entire gamut of revealed truths were at the disposal of the apostles in their own way. That's how theologians say it, in their own way. They had intimate connection with the entire gamut of revealed truths in their own way, in their own language, in their own terms. And these terms might not be the same terms that we use today. However, they didn't have like a distinct knowledge of all the elements of a dogma. They didn't have like, maybe they could brand, like trace everything out into every facet of Christology. And nor did they have a systematic or scientific knowledge of dogmas. The apostles did not think like of the Trinity in terms of subsisting relations. They didn't think of Christology in terms of hypostasis and those kind of ideas, these Greek terms that we see later on, or eternal procession or co-eternal, things like this. This kind of language might not have been the language the apostles used, but they still had an intimate understanding of this in an implicit sense, and they taught that in an implicit sense. And so an analogy might be helpful here. I think this analogy is really important and really useful when we're talking about the relation of the ship from the apostles to the deposit of faith. And so imagine you're married, okay? I know most of my audience, they're incels or something. I'm not sure, but I'm just kidding. But imagine that you're married and your wife is going to, your wife, of course, she's going to know you the most intimately. If someone was ever to know you the best, it would probably be your wife. She can predict your needs. She has like an intuitive sense of your personality and your proclivities. She can just tell like what your mood is. And I've assumed here that, you know, you've been married for many decades. Now let's say a biographer comes along, because you're like famous. One of my audience members is famous. And so a biographer comes along and he wants to write a book on you. And so the biographer, he may dig up certain details that your wife hadn't known before about your childhood. Your biographer may be able to find things that your wife didn't know about, or to apply certain rules of psychology and certain psychological rules. Again, idea of what's going on in your mind to understand how you tick. Like, they can look at like rules of psychology or something like that, or diagnose you with certain mental disorders. And so for my audience, it'd probably be autism. Maybe you know, the biographer can diagnose you with autism, which maybe your wife didn't have that term to understand you with. And so the biographer may have these scientific understanding, but ultimately your wife knows you better. And so the biographer, again, he might have a scientific understanding, he might even be more detailed in certain ways in his depictions of you, but ultimately it's your wife that has that intimate real connection to you, that really knows you, who you are. And the same is true of the apostles. So true, the apostles, they had a very intimate understanding of the positive faith. They understood it in their own terms, in the best possible way, in its varying facets. But the church, but the way that the apostle might express this might be in vague terms. And then the church later on might clarify things in ways that are more scientific or that are more detailed in certain aspects. But again, the apostles, of course, had the most intimate understanding. And then at first, the very nature of the doctrines basically makes it impossible for the apostles to transmit it all its facets with perfect perspicuity. The human, as quote, this is from a, here's a quote from my Dogmatic Theology book here. Let me blow this up. So quote, the human intelligence, even when copiously illuminated by supernatural light, cannot immediately and singly grasp and distinctly explain all their facets. They are so fruitful that they possess widely divergent application for varying conditions and needs that arise throughout the centuries. And so the very nature of the doctrines, the very nature of those things that God has revealed, they basically can't be revealed in perfect perspicuity at any time because of how immensely divergent they are, and the fact that they apply in certain circumstances more fittingly in others. In other words, that the dogmas, they don't need to be completely laid out at the very start of the church, since they had this very general understanding of what is true. And it wasn't until like a heresy arose in the church that clarification and further explication was necessary. This explication of the dogma was in fact something that was needed and necessary. And so the apostles, you know, they had this really deep and intimate understanding of these truths, but they're going to pass it down in the way in maybe implicit terms, and that's fine, that's okay. And because of the multifaceted nature of the dogma, it really isn't until the church runs into conflict, until people start questioning the doctrine of the church, that you really have to clarify these things and you have to have a deeper explanation. And furthermore, the apostles lack just certain scientific ways of speaking about dogma that everyone uses. For Catholics, this is very true about Aristotelian categories. We love using Aristotelian categories, and obviously the apostles were not as exposed to those ideas. We are exposed to Aristotelian ideas and categories, and so we can have a more scientific exegesis of dogma. But even other Greek terms that were used at the very in some of the first few ecumenical councils, like hypostatic, we talk about Christology, we talk about the hypostatic union, that Christ is all man and all God. This was not something that was explicitly taught at the very beginning of the church. This was not something explicitly taught by the apostles, but later on, using the teaching of the apostles and running into these heresies that arose, Donatism and the Ebionites and Doceticism, not the Donatists, Doceticism and other various heresies, Monophyletism, they begin to realize that we need to clarify these things, we need to use more scientific language. Other things like the perichoresis, choresis, let me try to pronounce this correctly. Perichoresis. It's a Greek word, and it basically means it relates to the Trinity. And this is another one of those like kind of scientific words that are used by the early church. And I'm using these examples from the early church from some of the beginning times because that was before the Great Schism. Again, my point in this time is to very much counter the Orthodox. The Eastern Orthodox do not believe that dogmas can progress in any meaningful sense. So I'm showing that yes, there was ambiguity at the beginning, and there had to be ambiguity at the beginning because of the nature of dogmas. They were so multifaceted, and it was okay because it wasn't until later that these heresies arose that they would need to be clarified, and it wasn't until then that we maybe had the language to better explain them. And so the sacraments, Christology, the Trinity, these things were better exposed later on. And nor was it necessary for the apostles to lay out like all these expressions, Christology and the sacraments, in very explicit terms, given that the method that the apostles are using, which is just street preaching. People need to understand that the early church relied on popular, it was very popular, not scientific explanations of Christian truth. And so the apostles taught everything that was necessary for salvation, don't get me wrong. And they taught the entire deposit of faith. But they taught things in a very popular sense, not a scientific sense. It relied less on formulas and abstract ideas, the stuff that I talk about here on the show, but they preferred like practical applications. They led by example, they baptized people, they created institutions, and they taught people in very much a pastoral way. And so if you read the New Testament, it's not a systematic theology textbook. It's not. And if you read a systematic theology textbook, Lutheran, Catholic, Eastern Orthodox does not come off. The way that they write is not the same as the Bible. It's clearly, if you read the Bible, especially the letters of St. Paul, there are two various churches telling them how to act. St. Paul is telling these churches that you need to celebrate the Lord's Day. You need to, on the Lord's Day, break bread. You need to have the Eucharist. You need, before taking the Eucharist, to examine yourself so that you're not taking it unworthily. And so contained within this very pastoral judgment is this idea of transubstantiation, the holy sacrifice, the Mass. So it's contained there implicitly, but the way in which the apostles are teaching is not going to make these things, is not going to be in this very scientific way that the church later came to understand these terms. They're preaching at people, obviously. They weren't instructing theologians like I am. Or I'm not a theologian, but like the way I'm trying to instruct you guys on theology, this is not the case in the early church. And so that's why it took until like the First Council of Nicaea to explain clearly aspects of the Trinity and to lay to rest the Arian heresy. It wasn't until Nicaea, the first ecumenical council, that we're able to get like a clear idea of the Trinity. And the Trinity is something that's very important, given the fact the Old Testament, we're talking about monotheism. The New Testament, now you have Jesus, all God, and he has all man, and then you have the Holy Spirit too, who's God, and so you have to kind of come to terms with these things. And the apostles did not teach in very explicit terms, like again, perichoresis, but this was implicitly taught. And again, it's because of the multifaceted nature of the dogma, it's because because of the way the apostles were preaching, and because of the fact that these scientific terms just didn't exist at the same time. And in fact, really, it's an act of love. It's an act of love that, and this is like, it all makes sense in God's plan that God would allow this, because the deposit of faith is like a fertile field. It's like a fertile field that continuously bears new fruit. And so it's like a grapevine grows out of this fertile field, and it continuously grows fruit, bears fruit throughout the ages, so that theologians and people like me who are curious can find rich and new discoveries in the dogma. So I think it really is in God's like grand plan. I really think it's an act of love for God to do this, because it satiates, you know, this certain curiosity that I have and other theologians have. We can discover new things. We can find ways of talking about dogmas in new ways. We can use new categories. We can express terms that we've talked about that existed since the early church in more explicit and more exact terms, so that we can avoid heresies, and that's very important, that we avoid like these heresies that pop up. And let me tell you, there's a lot of truths that can still be discovered if people are interested in watching and want to be theologians. There are still lots of interesting and rich theological truths that are out there, especially related to things like the Trinity, predestination. These are ideas that are continuously being debated, models to explain these things. All right, let me take a drink of water here. All right, so that's the first bullet point that I believe I've kind of explained, is some truths in the deposit of faith are obscure. They were revealed by the apostles in a very obscure way, again, because of the multifaceted nature of the dogmas. It made it difficult to explain them all, given the fact that the apostles were being very pastoral. And then given given the time period, the fact that the scientific terms hadn't developed and heresies hadn't developed yet, it wasn't necessary. Second part, the church did not clearly clarify immediately. So the second part I need to like kind of show is that the church did not clarify immediately at her conception these obscure truths. And the reason why we have to show that is that we can then show that the church could do this today. So the church didn't immediately after the death of the apostles preach in clear and unmistakable terms the truth, which was contained only obscurely in the source of Revelation, and it didn't need to clarify every detail of the doctrine, because there was no controversy, like I said. People accepted obscure teachings, in a sense. They accepted mysteries. Now, for example, they just accepted that Jesus Christ was really, truly, and substantially present in the Eucharist. To this day, Orthodox do not like to talk about the Eucharist in terms of transubstantiation. They like have this kind of early church way of thinking about the Eucharist, which is it's a mystery, that Jesus is really truly substantially present there, but we don't really understand it. And that was fine. That's fine if nobody questions it. If nobody like has questions, if nobody says like, how does this work? Or if there's no skeptics, as there really haven't been in the Eastern Church, then it's not a big deal. It's not an issue. But in the West, there were a lot of skeptics and people who were like, that questioned the true nature of Christ in the Eucharist. And so they needed to be theories of transubstantiation to make sense, to make intelligible what was happening at every altar in the world. We have now this term transubstantiation to explain how the Eucharist becomes for us the body, blood, soul, and divinity of Christ, how we make sense of those things. And there are other examples as well. And so I'm going to quote here from some of the church fathers and kind of, again, provoke the same idea that there are things that the early church taught in either unclear ways or even, in fact, wrong ways. There are many church fathers that taught things that were just wrong and the church just didn't need to clarify until later. For example, Origen distinguished, I'm quoting here from my Dogmatic Theology book, in case people want to fact check this. Origen distinguished between doctrines which are, quote, mostly openly preached in the churches, which, quote, have been defined in the church's preaching, about which, quote, there is complete unanimity in the whole church, and other doctrines which, quote, have to be sought for to the best of one's ability from sacred scripture, and have to be investigated with a wise analysis, in which, quote, there is not yet a clear-cut knowledge, which, quote, are not made known in obvious preaching, and about which, quote, it is not evident in ecclesiastical preaching that the doctrine is being taught. In other words, that there are some things that the early church did make very clear, and that they were necessary for the faith, and there are other things that are not necessary for salvation, or either because in and of themselves they aren't necessary, or maybe they go into more detail and get into more of a scientific analysis of certain dogmas. Regardless, that the Origen here is an early church participant. He wasn't, technically a father since he had some heretical views, but he says here that there are something things that are not clear-cut. And so we see that from the very beginning of the church, not everything was made explicitly known and made explicitly clear. And then Augustine distinguishes between, quote, an error which can be tolerated in questions that have not been diligently investigated and which have not yet been fully stabilized by the authority of the church, end quote, and errors which are tolerable, quote, which threaten to undermine the very foundation of the church. In another place he writes, quote, there are some matters about which even the most learned and best defenders of the Catholic rule of faith sometimes disagree among themselves, and one express better and more truly some point than another man. But the matter we are now dealing with, and the context is original sin in the baptism of children, belongs to the very foundation of the faith. End quote. In other words, that there are some times when we can disagree among themselves, as St. Augustine says, and one can express better or more truly some point than another man. And then there are other times that the church has clarified. So there are certain... And these are, again, these are church fathers here we're talking about. Augustine and Origen, who, you know, is in the early church. And so there are certain times when the church has clarified and made clear things based on heresies that arose. And there are other things that the church hadn't yet made clear. And there was just an implicit understanding. And that's why Augustine says and Origen says that people can disagree about this. And this is entirely okay. An implicit understanding is entirely sufficient, given that, one, these aren't necessary for salvation. Two, that if you look at other examples like the Israelites or the Jews in the Old Testament, they did not have the full law. They did not live by the full law that we have today. They did not have the new covenant. They had a different covenant, and yet they were still saved. They were still fine. You have people who are invincibly ignorant. They are still saved. They are still fine. You had people in the early church who died without knowing that the Holy Spirit spirates from both the Father and the Son, and the hypostatic union and perichoresis, and all these terms that were laid out in Ephesus and Nicaea and Chalcedon, and they died long before that, and they were still saved. And other examples include, like in Augustine's day, rather Augustine's day of traducianism. Traducianism. I think, yeah, I'm saying that correctly. Traducianism is basically this idea that the soul comes from your parents. And again, for people who are like tagging me in the comments, I'll answer all questions afterwards. But traducianism is basically this idea that your soul comes from your parents' soul. The parents' souls kind of split off in the same way that their parents' genome like combines together to create your genome. The parents' souls come together to create your soul. And that's not the view most philosophers and most theologians today that are either Reformed or Catholic take. It's very much we believe in what's called creationism, that God creates every soul ex nihilo. And so traducianism, though, was the belief in Augustine's day. They believed in traducianism. This has been shown wrong. This has been shown incorrect and insufficient philosophically, metaphysically, and yet people believe this. They were wrong in the early church. Not everything had been clarified. Not all dogmas had been sufficiently clarified. And then the third part is here, that the church did clarify with time. The church did clarify as time progressed. That is the third point that I'm going to try to prove. Again, the point of this whole discussion is to prove that dogmatic progression is real and has happened in the church prior to the Great Schism, prior to the Reformation, and my hope is then to show that, okay, the final point is that it can continue again in the future, so that then we can later on talk about whether or not things like papal supremacy, papal infallibility, purgatory, as it's understood today by the Catholic Church, whether these are valid dogmatic, another valid dogmatic progress has occurred with these dogmas. All right, so now the third point. Over the course of the century, the Church has in fact posed in clear-cut fashion many truths which had been only obscurely revealed. This is obviously true based on just the fact alone that certain saints held erroneous views, which were later condemned as heresies. Like I kind of just mentioned, Augustine with traducianism. For example, Saint Cyprian, he believed that it was okay. You had to rebaptize heretics. He believed that you had to rebaptize heretics. And so there are things that were not clear in the very beginning of the church. They were obscure. They were obscurely taught by the apostles. They were not clarified in the very beginning of the church. People disagreed, and then later they were clarified. They were clarified because today we know, both whether or not you're Lutheran, Catholic, Protestant, Anglican, Eastern Orthodox, you don't need to rebaptize a heretic. Someone who apostatizes or becomes a heretic and then repents, they don't need to be rebaptized. And yet Saint Cyprian did believe this. He's a saint. For Catholics, St. Thomas Aquinas did not believe in the Immaculate Conception. St. Augustine believed in traducianism and this very erroneous view of the soul. And so St. Vincent of Leroux, I think he's a French monk, lived in, I believe, the 5th century, 5th, 6th century. He says, quote, "Oh, strange turn of affairs. The originators of the same opinion are judged to be Catholics, while the followers are called heretics. The teachers are absolved. The disciples are blamed. The writers of the books will be the sons of the kingdom, but the promulgators will end up in hell." End quote. And how is that possible? How is it possible for these people who have promulgated error to be, and there have been popes that promulgated error in the past, there's been all sorts of things. How is that possible? Well, it's only possible if the church had not made clear some dogma in the past, which it would later make clear. That's the only way that we can understand St. Vincent of Leroux here. Early church father, is if in the past something had not been clearly defined by the church, and then later on it was clearly defined by the church, and so now anyone who holds to a view contrary to the church's view is in error. They're either in disobedience or they're in heresy. They're just being heretical. It's the only way you can really understand what St. Vincent of Leroux is saying, or what the situation that happened with St. Cyprian, or the situation with Thomas Aquinas, though I guess if that's not very going to be very convincing to the schismatics and the Protestants, but the same concept exists there. All right, last part here, fourth part, that same process can occur again. That same process in which the church later clarifies something that was obscurely shown. So the apostles obscurely taught some truths. We demonstrated why this is true. Two, the church didn't clarify these immediately. The church did later on clarify certain things that were taught obscurely. And then the fourth thing, the fourth like proposition here is that the same process of relative dogmatic progression can happen again. And by again, I both mean in the future today, as well as after the Great Schism or after the Reformation or something like that. And it just makes sense that the church will be able to preach in more clear-cut fashion some truths, which maybe today are not clearly enunciated, or maybe weren't clearly enunciated after the first seven ecumenical councils. Surely the church can do in the future what she did at Nicaea with the Trinity, at Ephesus with the Theotokos. Again, I don't think the apostles are using terms like Theotokos, and there's debate about whether to use Theotokos or Christotokos, Christotokos, something like that. It means like is Mary the Son of God, or is she the Son of Christ? Or rather, she's the Mother of God, or the Mother of Christ. And this related to this this false view of Christology that was being debated at the time, Doceticism, in which there was two persons. There's two persons that constituted the second entity of the Trinity. There was the person of Jesus, and then there's the person of the Logos, and they're kind of connected in some sense, maybe like they act together. Anyway, there's two separate persons, and so Mary is not the Mother of God, the second person of the Trinity, but rather the mother of the human nature of God. But no, there's only one person. That's what Council of Ephesus clarified. There's only one person, and that person has two natures, both a human nature and a divine nature, fully and completely. And so again, this is another progression. There's a progression in the way we talk about this dogma, and the terms we use about this dogma, the way we think about this dogma, that is going to be different than the way that the apostles talked about it or understood it, and the early church might have talked about it and understood it. You have at Nicaea 2. This is a great example to bring out to anyone who's Orthodox. At Nicaea 2, iconoclasm was condemned. Iconoclasm is the ancient heresy that basically says that pictures depicting saints, pictures depicting Jesus, these things are bad, they're evil. And obviously comes from this very kind of Jewish idea that you can't make graven images. And you know, the Jews did not like a lot of graven images. They weren't huge fans of it. They didn't use a lot of those. And so you have St. Luke, who according to tradition made the first icon. And then you had these two varying schools of thought. That some believe that, you know, it's okay to have icons. Other believes that we should destroy icons. And so you have these two schools of thought that were both like Orthodox, or both within the church until Nicaea 2, in which it clarified the stance on icons. And so there was clearly a progression from Luke. The Apostle Luke did not teach in clear and uncut terms that icons were okay. It's okay to use icons. This is their usage. This is what they're for. They can actually have certain, they can scare away demons. They're like almost like sacramentals, which is the belief of the Orthodox Church. The Orthodox Church has a very strong veneration of icons. They have a very strong theology relating to icons. Very, almost obsessive with the iconography. And so there's clearly some progression, and this progression led to the Second Council of Nicaea. You also have Chalcedon, that again clarified some Christological doctrines like the hypostatic union. And so if the church can do this in the past, if the church can do this, related to issues that affect more the Orthodox Church or the Catholic Church, if they could do that in the past, back when the Catholic and Orthodox Church were, you know, together, united, the East and the West were united, if the Church had done that in the past, it clearly used language and the way they talked about dogmas is clearly its progression in the way we thought about things. If they could do that in the past, and there's no reason to think it couldn't do that now. And so new disputes arise in the Church, as they do, they are arising in the Church, related to Vatican II, related to ecumenism, related to those issues, then it's the the duty of the church to clarify these things. And so after the Great Schism, there was these questions about what is the Pope's role in the church. There was disputes about that. There was disputes about the sinless nature of Mary. And so the church clarified these things. And of course, you can continue to clarify them as long as there is some deposit that is contained in implicit form. As long as the idea behind the dogma is contained in some implicit form at the very beginning. And so at the very beginning of the church, you had St. Luke making an icon. He showed that the icons are okay, but he clearly didn't teach that in clear, uncut terms because there was debate. There was disagreement. And it makes sense they want to teach that maybe in uncut terms, just because, again, the point of the apostles was they did a lot of things through action, not so much laying out systematic theologies. And so the same thing can happen after the Reformation or after the Great Schism with things like papal infallibility, with things like the Immaculate Conception. And that's basically the second part that I'm going to talk about in maybe tomorrow or another video, is how can we know when there is organic, valid development of dogma versus when there's an accretion or an innovation or we're just inventing things from thin air. When are we just using new terms to describe things or in more scientific terms, the same way that a psychologist might be able to use new terms to talk about your, like, you diagnose you with autism or something like that, but you obviously know yourself. And so you might have an obscure understanding of yourself, but a psychologist might be have like a more scientific understanding or something like that. So using that analogy and relating to the church, we're going to create a standard for it, and then another subsequent video I will also apply those things to dogmas in contention like purgatory and the Immaculate Conception, like that. So thank you guys for listening to this video. Gone on for almost an hour, so long this has been a long video, but I'll see you guys in the next one.